So what we're going to talk about here a little bit is, I think it's really helpful. We learn so much at a conference like this, and we hear so much, but sometimes it can be hard to know how to apply that practically into our own lives. How do we abide in Christ? How do we follow Jesus by abiding in him in the way that we just heard in John 15? And I'm just going to read again that verse 7 from John 15. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, then ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. So how do we do that practically? So we're going to have a little discussion here about how we practically abide in the Word of God. So to start off, Carol, since you're sitting over here.
I'm starting over here.
We heard enough from Karen already. Just kidding. How did you begin to abide in the Word on a regular basis? Do you remember a time when you weren't reading the Word of God, and what changed, and how did that change? And if each of you could answer that question.
Oh, absolutely. Seasons of life, and I confess, I'm in and out. I don't have this mastered. Some days it is absolutely in the Word, reading. Sometimes it's just reading, sometimes it's studying. In my world, it's different. But it's reading to find, to see Christ in it.
Okay, thanks.
I would have a similar answer. It's definitely seasonal. And I think that's okay. You know, I think I oftentimes get wrapped in the law versus relationship. Like, I feel like I should be in the Word because that's a good thing, but I'm not in it to know him. I'm in it to check it off my list. And so I've wrestled with that a lot in the different seasons of life. And the times that I have felt closest to him are actually the deepest periods of suffering in my life. And it's funny, this may sound completely crazy, but there have been times in my life that I have actually desired suffering. I know that sounds crazy, but because of the intimacy that I gain from being in the Word, because I have nothing else to look to, I am completely and utterly dependent on Christ in those seasons. And so it's in these seasons of health and these seasons of blossoming, I don't know what the right, I can't think of the right word, that actually are harder for me to motivate myself to get into the Word because I'm not utterly dependent on it. So it's something I'm, like Carol said, I'm a work in progress in that.
Thank you. And I'd just like to interject here and say, and I think what we're going to hear, because just from listening to you, my response is a little bit different and will come around to me. But so we do have different experiences of how we get into the Word and what that looks like in each of our lives. And that's okay. So Laurie, you tell us about how you get into the Word. And do you remember a time when you weren't in the Word, and how did that change?
Well, I have been, I feel, in a season of like a desert experience for a while now. And what you were saying about the law and doing it, you know, sometimes there are times I am more of a, you know, you should do it person sometimes. But that can carry you through a desert experience. I can get up in the morning and I know I need to do this, and I read the Word and I do the Word, and I meet with God, and that brings me to that point of knowing that he's still there. It brings me back to my foundation, back to my rock, back to what I really know is true. And that's part of being faithful, and that's part of abiding, even if you don't feel it.
Go ahead, Karen. Thank you, Laurie.
Well, I agree with all of the women up here. I do think there are seasons, and especially in the different seasons, the way that we're in the Word might vary because of just what our life looks like. But I also agree with Lori that there is some sense of self-discipline to it, to know the truth and say, I know that my heart needs to be reminded of the truth, even if I don't feel like it. Uh-huh. Or sometimes I think there's seasons where we resist the truth because we don't really want to hear it. We know what it is, and we're not ready
Amen.
To move on with it. And so in those moments, it's important to just make the conscious decision to get in the Word. And He does not disappoint. I mean, you know, we get in there maybe even with a little rebellious attitude, and yet there's something that we come out with, maybe just this morsel or nugget that the whole rest of the day, you know, is like that sand in an oyster that just kind of rubs you. And maybe it's rubs you tender and it's sore and you didn't want to hear it, but it bears beauty in the end.
Okay. Thank you. I think you just touched on something that's very important, which is, while I trusted in Jesus Christ when I was 8 years old, my life from there on after was kind of bipolar. I wanted to love the Lord Jesus, but I also fully wanted to experience what the world had to offer. I was born into a Christian home, and I knew the way that I should walk, but I wanted to see what it was like to walk that other way over here. And in those times when I was willfully sinning, you can bet that I did not want to be reading the Word of God, because the Word of God is going to pierce my heart. And we're going to come back to that in a little bit. And so, we have to have some self-discipline to get into the Word, even when we don't feel like it. And what is our motivations for that? Well, I think part of our motivation is if we love God, we want to serve Him. We want to know Him better. And so that drives us into the Word, because that is how we get to know Him better. But I wanted to just share a brief nugget, something that occurred to me. You got to quit doing that, Whitney. I'm like, what does my expression say right now? I shouldn't be thinking about that. But thanks, Julie. But this little nugget was, I don't know, maybe 10 years ago, I suddenly thought, what if I got to heaven and I meet God and He had given me this Word that He had written down for me through men for me to learn about Him, and I get to heaven and I haven't even read it all? And I suddenly realized, I do not want to have that conversation with God. I don't even, not that He would make me feel bad, but you know, who wants to say to God, well, yeah, I know you gave me this, but I was kind of busy when I was down there, you know? So that was a motivator for me, and I really wanted to spend time every day just reading a little bit. So that is what I try to do, but it's not every day, I can assure you, but I try. All right.
Can I interject here?
Absolutely.
I think our, so many times when we're thinking about the quiet time and everything, you know, I have to do this, and I have to get into this, and I have to. And we are in seasons of life, and when you have young children, you don't always have time to do that. And what you say about getting nuggets and everything, sometimes that's all it is. Maybe you have 5 minutes, and you just take those 5 minutes and you open the Word, or you listen to some little thing on the radio, and you say, oh yeah, thank you God for that little bit of time. Because you can't take the time that you want to take. And sometimes it won't be in the morning. Sometimes it'll be late at night after your kids go to bed, before you fall asleep. And because you have to fall asleep. So, you know, you have to remember that there are various times and various seasons. And it's okay. You don't have to be perfect in what you do. You just have to spend time with God. Sorry.
No, please. That was one of the things we were going to touch on. So let's expand on that. What if you are that mom whose waking moment is actually at 3 a.m. when the baby starts crying, and then from that moment on, you have no time to even complete a thought? Been there. Never mind actually spend time sitting down in the Word. You would love to sit down with that cup of Starbucks or your tea, your chai tea or whatever that is. And I'm a coffee drinker. But yeah, you know, you would just love to sit down and have half an hour to read the Word. But my goodness, there's no end to the throwing up children and the dirty diapers, and then Dad comes home and where's my dinner? And you know how it is. So when do you, in that time, or maybe you're not in that season of life right now, but But maybe you're in the season of life where you have a job that is just all consuming, and then when you get home, you still have that husband who's expecting dinner on the table. Been there too. Anyway, no, don't tell Rod that. But anyway, he does not do kitchens, let me say, so that's been hard. But how do you
get into
the work?
You know this is being recorded, right?
What's that?
This is being recorded.
No.
I just thought you should know for future reference.
So yeah, can you give us some practical ways that, whether it's in the Word or how do you abide in Christ when life is like that?
Well, for me, actually, I don't have little babies right now. My sweet little youngest is 6. And we've been actually diving into this book that the kids got for their baptism called Theology. And it walks through scripture in a little more simplified form for kids. But it is beautiful. It gives a wonderful explanation of the gospel from beginning to end of scripture. And this beautiful picture of it. And I go away from reading those little nuggets so filled with the Spirit, and having done it with my kids and them asking questions, and sometimes that's all I get in the day, and that fills me. You know, there's no right or wrong way to be in the Word. I think God gives us multiple tools for that. I personally, I love music, and so there have been times in my journeys when I feel like I don't even have the strength to open scripture. And God brings a song on the radio or to mind that reminds me of his truths. And a lot of songs out there are literally scripture put to music. And that is such a beautiful way to be in the Word and to help you remember it as well. We are wired for that. I mean, how many of you can recall lyrics from songs from like junior high? You know, the song comes on and immediately that song comes back to mind, because there's something wired inside of us to be naturally inclined to remember something put to music. So there's a lot of, I think, value in that as well. It's something that works for me.
And just to kind of dovetail off of what both of these ladies have said, there is no perfect way to do it. So if you are wired to be the perfectionist, don't let Satan stop you. It is a spiritual battle. Just get in the Word. I can't do it perfect, so I'm not going to do it at all. I mean, I've been there, done that, and it doesn't matter what it is. Sometimes that attitude, that mentality, that focus on self instead of Christ just totally leads you astray and wander. But don't let that stop you. And remember, it's a spiritual battle. And as Heather said, it doesn't have to be big or small, a nugget. It's his Word, it's his truth, and it will reach you and teach you and bless you so you can bless others and produce fruit.
One thing I was just thinking of that perhaps I should have touched on in the message was that when it says to abide in the vine is a person, it's Jesus. And when it says to abide in the Word, you know, the Word is a person. So we abide in this Word, these words in this book, but we abide in them because we're abiding in a person. We're abiding in Jesus. There are people who spend a lot of time in the scripture who don't abide in the vine. They have a lot of head knowledge and wisdom according to theology, but they don't have relationship because they're not seeking the scripture to know the person. They're seeking it to know the wisdom and to use it as a tool. And so I think we just have to be careful with that. I mean, we want to be self-disciplined to be in the Word because we know this is where our hope and our truth is, because it points to the one who is our hope and truth. But we don't want to be so rigid about it that it becomes, you know, who knows more than someone else and who can recite things and who can point out maybe something you don't understand. So we live in the Word because it's a person we're seeking after. And when we have that heart, I think he beckons to us more.
And that's something where, even though we may not have a time in the day. And I think particularly when you're suffering physical pain, if you're sick, sick to your stomach, or you have the flu, or you're going through a longer term illness, I think pain, physical discomfort, is debilitating when it comes to reading and even praying. But if you have that, or if just have a day where you've got little kids, or you're taking care of somebody, a loved one, and you don't have time to sit down and spend time in the Word, first of all, you can pray. And abiding in Christ is not just His Word abiding in us, but it's also, as you said, us abiding in Him. And prayer is the fundamental way in which we can abide in Him. And you can pray anytime, and you can pray for just a few seconds at a time. But I do think that if we can spend time in the Word, the fruit that bears is that when we're in those times of intense suffering, like you talked about, the Word comes back to us, and we think of things that, and God brings those things to mind that we have read in His Word, and then they are a source of peace and encouragement. So, okay, we have time for just one more question.
Can I share one thing real quick? I really wanted you guys to hear some practical things. So one thing, when I had really young children, my youngest is 2, so to me she seems older because infancy is hard and exhausting, and she's a tornado, but she's better than she was. But one thing that was just, for all of these years since I had them like one after the other, that was just really useful was actually this app on my phone called YouVersion. It looks like a brown Bible that just says Holy Bible on it, but you can pick any translation that you want. And it can actually download it to your phone, and there's an audio button on it. And so for years, you know, if we would jump in the car, I would just turn on the audio Bible. Or even in the morning, if I wake up and I have to wash the dishes or get stuff done, because you only have this small moment of time before crazy steps in. And so I'll turn on the audio Bible while I'm washing dishes. And so the audio version for me has been a huge lifesaver, because I can multitask with little kids. So practically speaking, that's just been useful to me.
So then I have to dovetail off what Karen just said, and something that was challenging to me. I think it was Bill Bright's wife, and I'm sorry, Bill Bright's wife, but I actually don't remember her first name. But anyway, she had talked about how, you know, she was a mom and she had such busy days, but she trusted in God for her sleep, and she kind of gave that to Him. And so she would wake up sometimes in the middle of the night, and this is when she was already somewhat sleep deprived just from the, you know, kinds of days that she had. And when she would wake up, she would get up and she would trust God for her, I guess, for her renewal through sleep by getting into His Word until she was tired, and then she would go back to bed. And even though she might spend a half an hour or an hour in the middle of the night praying and reading His Word, she would never be tired in the morning, because she asked Him to overrule that. And I'm like, wow. But it gave me a different perspective, which is, you know, I personally, I'm a morning person. Well, it's not. That's another whole thing. But so I get up early in the morning and I spend time with God, and that is a great time. But truthfully, I have to fight thinking about other stuff that's not God. So it's a battle. But that's my time in the morning.
I think, too, it's easy for us as women to feel like we're not measuring up a lot of times, and have these heavy expectations on us. And so when we feel like we are not doing enough, or feeling like we are not in the Word enough, the enemy starts creeping in and places that guilt on us. Because Jesus he dealt with that at the cross. And so when we feel that guilt creeping in, we need to say, away from me, Satan, and start quoting scripture. Even if you can't carve out a few minutes to sit in the Word, use what you have already known to recall during that time and meditate on that. Don't sit in the guilt of that, because that's negating what Christ has done. Instead, immerse yourself in the truth.
All right, so we have one time for one more question, I think. And I'd just like to read Hebrews 4:12, which says, "For the word of God is a living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and of spirit, of joints and of marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart." Can any of you or all of you share a verse of scripture that God used to pierce your heart? Okay, I'll go first because they're struggling a little bit. I'll go first. Okay. There's so many verses. I guess let me start with one that's a little easier, which is from 1 Corinthians 13. In fact, that whole chapter, if you're familiar with 1 Corinthians 13, it talks about, if I'm all that in a bag of chips, if I have all this knowledge and if I can have faith that moves mountains, but I have not love, I'm nothing. And that is like my life verse. One of my challenges with sin is I have a tendency to think that I'm all that and a bag of chips. And I have to struggle with that. And that is a sin, so here's my confession time. But in that verse from, or those verses from Corinthians 13, it reminds me that if I don't love people the way Jesus that loves people, all that other stuff, it's worthless. It's nothing. It is only through love that God works through us. And Paul was speaking to that because he was kind of all that in a bag of chips when before he was saved, and he knew too that it's only through the love of people that that God would use him. And some of you know that recently I've been through a life challenge, and I'm still going through that life challenge right now. But in times of adversity is when God tends to work the most intensely in our lives. And so I wanted to share with you something that has pierced my heart. Because when we do read the Word, God uses it to change us and to grow us and to transform us, and sometimes that can be painful. So there's a couple of verses that I want to share from you from Romans 12. First, from Romans 12, verse 3. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think with sober judgment. That pierces my heart. And then also from Romans 12, verse 16. Never be wise in your own sight. So these are verses that God uses, and I love him for piercing my heart because I want to be transformed. I want to be more like Jesus. And it is a lifelong process, starting when I was 8, but it will not stop until I reach heaven, and then I will be made perfect, and not until then. But this is why we read the Word, because it pierces our hearts. Do you guys have anything you can share?
Okay, I've always also been going through a life challenge within the last year. Matthew 11:28-29. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. I'm one of those people who is a perfectionist, a Pharisee, judgmental, all those things. And so I judge myself too much sometimes and expect too much of myself. So Jesus says, come to me. Abide in me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and that heavy laden is those burdens that we place on ourselves. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. One of the women that I think it was Jill Briscoe talked about these verses, and she said that one of the ways you can look at that burden is when you're in the boat and Jesus gives you just enough that your boat can hold. not more than your boat can hold. And I just have to quickly say that, God, I said, God, I can't do this after Dave died. I can't do this. No, I don't want to do this. I know I can, but I don't want to do this. And I feel like I'm drifting along. And God says, well, Laura, you like to take a boat ride, so just relax and enjoy it. So when I heard that about it, the load being just right for the boat, it was perfect for me. So, you know, God pierces my heart and says, I've got this. It's okay. Don't worry about it. But that's hard to do. So there's my piercing.
For me, there's a lot of scripture that has pierced my heart, but one that has stuck with me ever since that day when I was 16 was Romans 8:28. It says, and we know that God works for the good. We know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who are called according to his purpose. You know, and it's not good according to our standards. It's good according to his, because he allows suffering. And that's not good in our eyes, but it is in his, because it reveals him in a different light. It draws us closer to him, and he is good. And whatever can bring us closer to him and in more deeper recognition of who he is and our need of him and what he's done for us, that is good. And if God is good and he desires good for his people, that whatever he allows us to walk through, we can trust that it's good. It may not seem like it right now. It may not seem like it in our definition of it, but ultimately it is for good and for his glory.
I'm constantly convicted by scripture. It's, you know, I'm not even sure where to begin, because every time I open it, I'm kind of pierced by it. I guess one thing is that last year when this illness was taking place, which still continues, we still thought we were going to get an answer. And so it was kind of this like enduring suffering kind of mentality, and being patient in affliction, which is definitely from the word. But this year, as it continues, I was kind of pierced by this. Now I rejoice in my sufferings. And he says, that was in Colossians, and he says in Philippians, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. And then he goes on to say, but in everything, by prayer and supplication and with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. And so something that I'm wrestling through and not mastering this year is to be joyful in all of it. To be joyful in the unknown, and to be joyful in the pain and the suffering, and to be thankful for it, which is very different than just enduring it.
Okay. All right. Thank you so much, ladies. Well, our time is up for this panel discussion. So as we close here, I'm just going to pray, and I'd like to pray for you. You don't have to stand up, but I'm going to. Let's pray. Father God, you know our hearts. You know every word before it is even on our tongue. You know the detail of each of our circumstances for each one of us here today. You know what we face when we leave here. Father, I pray that you would help each individual here to abide in you, to abide in your Son, the Lord Jesus, in a way that is new and deeper than it was before they came here. You know what challenges we face. You know how to overcome them. I pray for the intervention of your Holy Spirit in each life here, that we may abide in your Son in a deeper way. In Jesus' name, amen.